as we prepare our hearts for worship. And I don't know about you, but there's just been a lot of chaos going on recently, a lot of distractions, a lot of things that are vying for my attention. And we all have our things. We all have our situations, whether they're good things or concerning things or bad things going on in our lives, Lord. We just ask that you would quiet yourself. You would quiet those distractions. We ask that God would quiet those distractions that are in our minds, that are taking away from our purpose, which is to worship the one true God. Psalm 90, verse 14 says, O satisfy us in the morning with your loving kindness, that we may sing for joy and be glad all of our days. Make us glad according to the days you have afflicted us and the years we have seen evil. Let your work appear to your servants and your majesty to their children. Let the favor of the Lord our God be upon us and confirm us to the work of our hands. Yes, confirm the work of our hands. Let us worship our everlasting God with joy and thanksgiving.
Calvary, how many of you are excited to be serving the everlasting God? Amen. Amen. We are excited to be in the house of the Lord this morning. We are so excited to see all these wonderful and beautiful and smiling faces. Thank you, everyone who is joining us in our virtual campus. We're happy to have you this morning. And as is our tradition, let's wave good morning to the balcony bunch. Oh, don't they look so beautiful up there? So this is the part of the service where we just take a little time just to confess our sins before the Lord. If there's anything that's weighing heavy on our hearts, we can just sort of release that to the Lord. So there's nothing that separates us as we just release ourselves to worship this morning. So as we go to the Lord with confession, I'll read what's in the white and you read what's in the gold and the bold. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sin, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Please take a few seconds to silently reflect upon the Lord. Amen. Most merciful God, we confess we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. By what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. And if you have confessed that by faith, receive the forgiveness that is found in our Lord Jesus Christ. And with that, we will continue in worship.
So when I fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And every fear I lay at your feet, I sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. When all I see is the battle, you see my victory. See is the mountain, you see a mountain move. And as I walk through the shadows, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So the battle belongs to you, and in every fear I lay at your feet. I sing through the night, oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me? For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. When all I see is a cross, God, you see an empty tomb. So when I fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. an almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. is the Lamb. You are holy, holy. Are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb.
Sing, worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb.
You are holy.
You are holy.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. As the cherubim declared, holy, 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 holy are you, Lord God Almighty. It's not that they stuttered. It's not that they couldn't think of anything better to say. It's that holiness is godliness. And it is so majestic and beautiful. Holy and set apart. Our Lord is so powerful and amazing and worthy of our praise. Creator and sustainer. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, Jesus Christ, to take away the sins of the world, to take away our sins. Worthy is the Lamb. You are holy. And Lord, we offer ourselves to you. Despite our filthy rags, despite our sin nature, despite our imperfections and our never-ending failures, but we offer you what we can and what we have and what we are. And we pray that what we give brings you joy. We just pray that you would wash us clean, white as snow, in your righteousness, in your mercy, in your grace, in your loving kindness. We're thankful for everything that you do, Lord. Let us not forget in any moment how much you love us and how worthy you are of our praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much for joining us for worship today. Please greet one another in the name of Jesus.
Amen. This is the time in our service where we worship through giving. So if you haven't had the opportunity, the ushers, we do have a giving box in the back. Could you do me a favor and lift up the giving box?
All right, so this box is easy to miss. You guys, turn around, take a look. It's brown like the table. It's easy to miss. So some of us like to pass our offering. And so if you feel the need to give this morning and you like to give the old paper money or the check, you have that option. You can give it in the giving box in the back. You can do that at any time during the service, or you can do it at the exit of the service, and we'll be trying to remind you at that time. And then also, if you prefer to give online, you can just go to the website, calvaryfargo.com, and you can click the give icon, and it'll take you straight away. And then there's lots of options to give there. You can give online in that way. And if you're joining us by streaming, there should be a link in the description, which you can click on if you desire to give from those locations. If you've been blessed by Calvary Fargo and you feel like you're a part of this worship service and part of this church. So with that, we'll now have the reading of the Apostles' Creed and the Scriptures.
Please stand with me for the reading of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. The reading today is from Genesis 2, verses 18 through 25. The Lord said, "It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him." Now the Lord God had formed out of the ground all the wild animals and all the birds of the sky. He brought them to the man to see what he would name them, and whatever the man called each living creature, that was its names. So the man gave names to all the livestock, the birds in the sky, and all the wild animals. But for Adam, no suitable helper was found. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. And while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs and then closed up the place with flesh. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man. The man said, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man." That is why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh. Adam and his wife were both naked, and they felt no shame. The next verses are from Genesis 3, verses 1 through 7. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it or you will die." "You will not certainly die," the serpent said to the woman, "for God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed big fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves.
The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may have your seats in the presence of the Lord. This week, we're going to be continuing in our life-driven series. This week, we're going to be talking about life-driven relationships. And so as part of talking about life-driven relationships, we're not going to be focused just on marriage. We're going to be talking a little bit about marriage. We're going to be talking about relationships in general, but we're going to be just talking about what healthy relationship, life-driven relationships look like when it comes to the Word of God. So with that, let's just dig right into the Scriptures, because there's going to be quite a bit of teaching this morning just from the Scriptures. So I'm excited to dig into the Word. And so there will be seven principles that we're going to talk about this morning. So in 18, verse 18, it says this: "The Lord God said, 'It is not good for the man to be alone. It is not good for the man to be alone. So just to recap from last week, we talked about, from two sermons ago, we talked about life-driven design. And when God created creation, he kept saying, I create something and it is good. I create something and it is good. I create something and it is good. And the word for good is tov, like you hear people in Jewish language, they say mazel tov. Tov is good. And that what that goodness means is it is a reflection of God, because Jesus said, there is none good but God. Only God is good. And because God is good, when he looks at his creation and he makes a declaration, and when God says it's good, he says, that's good. That reflects me. That reflects me. And so when God then comes along and he looks at the creation and he says, wow, I created something and it is not tov. It is not good. It doesn't reflect me. There's something missing. And so when he did that with man, he says, it's not good. God doesn't say that about a lot of things, but he says that in this case. He says, it is not good. And so what does it mean for something to be not good? For something to be not good. For God to say that, God says that because he understands us, because he created us. So for God to look at the creation and say not good, that's a big deal. And so when God's looking at the creation, he is saying something's incomplete. Something's not quite there. There's something better, some way I can improve it. It's not that the situation, it wasn't that the creation was not good, it's the situation is not good. And so principle number one is this for life-driven relationships. Life-driven relationships begin with understanding who we are. Life-driven relationship, if we're going to have life-driven relationship, it begins with understanding who we are. And part of understanding who we are is two things. We have to understand nurture and nature. We have to understand nurture and nature. So all of us, when it comes to nurture, we have our past, who we were. We have our present, who we are. And we have our future, who we will become. And so our past, we have our past experiences. We have our past passions, the things that, you know, we grew up. Think back to when you were a kid. What did you passionately want to do when you were a kid? My youngest once said, and I lament that she didn't follow this career path, but she once said when she was like 5 or 6, I'm going to be a Spider-Man doctor. And I thought that was a great combination. You know, if you're going to be a Spider-Man, you're going to be a superhero and a doctor, that is a great combination. And so what was those past aspirations? Those shape who you are. Your experiences from your past shape who you are. And coupled with your current circumstances, what you're experiencing today, who you are today, the job you work, the friends you hang around with, that shapes you also. And that currently is who you are today. Nurture. But then there's also your aspirations. What do you want to be in the future? What do you want to be in the future? What are the aspirations you hold? What are the dreams? What are the goals that you want to pursue in life? And are you still pursuing those dreams, those aspirations, those God-given something that the Lord put inside of you that he says, these are part of your nurturing? Now, here's a clue. If you're not already kind of moving towards that, because we as people of being people, we're creatures of habit, we tend to be operating our patterns of behavior. So what you've already done and what you're currently doing, the projection is if you're not already changing in some kind of significant way, you're probably going to be doing that 10, 15, 20, 25 years from now. Unless there's like some significant movement in your life, you're probably going to, whatever your trajectory is now, you're probably going to be that person in the future. The question is, what changes and shifts will you make based on the past aspirations, who you currently are, and who you currently desire to be in the future? Not only is there nurture, there's also nature. Nature is how we're wired, how we're designed, and how God has uniquely gifted us to impact others in the world. How we're wired, how we're designed, and how God has uniquely gifted us to impact the world. And so there's lots of ways to figure that out. And so one of the things that is very popular out there is you can take a personality assessment. Personality assessments, there's a lot of them out there. It kind of tells you how you're wired. Kind of tells you how you're geared, what you kind of lean towards, what are your giftings. And so there's a lot of different ones. Personality assessments, you can do Strength Finders. There's Myers-Briggs. There's the Enneagram, 16 personalities. You can do emotional intelligence assessment, Kiersey temperaments. There's the Big Five, and there's a lot more where that come from, including ones that evaluate spiritual giftings, all of those. And so for anybody who's interested in our congregation, I'm certified in the first two. And so if you're ever interested, you're like, hey, Pastor, I'm just kind of curious what my strengths are or what my MBTI score would be, how kind of I'm wired, feel free to just hit me up. And if you're a part of the congregation, we can just come in and talk, and I can issue one of those assessments for you. But all of those can help us, let us know how God has uniquely wired, designed us, and gifted us to impact others in the world. Going back to verse 18, it says this: the Lord God said, it is not good for the man to be alone. Alone. The Hebrew word for alone is bod. Not bad, like the Michael Jackson album. I know some of you, no, not bad, bod, Hebrew. And it means the part, the portion, or the limb, or a piece of a cloth. This is just the piece of the whole. So when God looked at man, he said, it is not good for man to be alone. It's not good for man to be a part without community, without relationship, without a bigger piece of the pie. It's not okay just to be a slice. He said, it's not good. This is not good. And so he didn't want a man to be alone. And so here's the principle number two. Life-driven relationships are communal by design. God desires for all of us to be in community. God did not design us to be hermits. He didn't design us to sit in caves by ourselves, dipping on stone tablets, saying, you know, I understand. That's different than being an introvert. Introverts have to recharge by having some alone time. But we're not talking about that. We're talking about people who intentionally say, I don't want any connection with anyone. I don't want connection with my family. I don't want connection with friends. I don't want connection with church. I don't want social connections at work. And God so wired us and understands us so well that he understands that there are risks associated with being alone. There are lots of risks associated with being alone. According to the Journal of Medicine, I forget which one off the top of my head, but according to them, here's some of the things they listed. And it says depression, Alzheimer's disease, alcoholism, stress on the immune system, suicide, personality disorder, sleep quality, and there's many more, are negative effects for people who are experiencing loneliness. And they saw an uptick in this with the COVID, with pandemics, especially among the elderly who were sheltered and didn't have family coming to visit them. And they were the most at risk. And they saw that when we are lonely, when we are just extensively by ourselves, it has a medical, physical, psychological, and an emotional impact. So God understood this about the way he designed us, and he says, it is not good for a person to be without community and without relationship. Going on, continuing in verse 18, it says, I will make a helper suitable for him. Now the Lord God had formed out of the ground all the beasts of the field, all the birds of the air. He brought them to the man to see what he would name them, and whatever the man called each of the living creatures, that was his name. The man gave them names to all the livestock, the birds in the sky, and the wild animals, but for Adam, no suitable helper was found. Notice God says, I'm going to design a suitable helper, a suitable relationship. Not all relationships are suitable for us. I know that's hard to understand, especially for us as Christians. We want to be loving, we want to be giving, but not every relationship is suitable for us, because principle number three is life-driven relationships require discernment. Life-driven relationships require discernment. Some people come into your life, God never really intends for you to be connected to them in any type of way. There's sort of a, you say goodbye and I say hello. Hello, hello. You say goodbye, I say hello. And so there's this hello, goodbye relationship. Hey, I wave at you. I don't know you. It was nice to see you, but that's it. And that's all God wants for a relationship. But then God has relationships where it's just a one-time meeting. It's only meant for be a one-time incident. And this may just be a messenger from God. Maybe somebody you meet one time and they give you a word of knowledge, or maybe they give you a prophetic word, or they just impact your life in that one moment. And God says that's all there's supposed to be out of this relationship. There's just this one-time connection with this person. But then there are relationships that are seasonal. Seasonal relationships are people who come into your life for a season, but they're not meant to be there for a lifetime. Now, for those of you who are dating or have dated, this is where it can get very confusing. Because sometimes you'll meet people, and you might think, this person is the one. And God is saying, no, this person is a friend. But Lord, I really like them. No, this person is a friend. This person is here for a season. This is not a lifetime, life-driven relationship. It's only there for a season. Sometimes we meet friends in church, and they'll be with us for a season. Maybe they'll attend our church for a while, or they'll be in our group, and then they'll go to another group or another church or move to another city. And we're like, well, Lord, this was my really good friend. Why did they have to leave? That relationship was only for a season. And we can get into a lot of trouble if we start defining seasonal relationships as lifetime relationships. And if we start to try to create connection and relationship outside of the season, the relationship sometimes becomes very wonky. So sometimes they're just seasonal relationships. But then there are lifetime relationships. And for those of you who waited on the Lord and chose correctly and your spouse, you may be experiencing one of those lifetime relationships. Or you have one of those friends that you've known since you were little, and they're still one of your best friends that you reach out to. Lifetime relationships. Those people are in your life for a purpose, for a reason, to help you grow. And it's really important that they stay in your life because God has connected you with them. And so you may be asking, well, how can I kind of determine what's a good relationship? Well, I'm going to use something we use in theology and theological reflection. It's called the Wesleyan Quadrilateral. A big thing within the Anglican Church and within just within churches in general is they use three pillars, what they call the three-pillar stool or the three-legged stool, scripture, tradition, and reason. Wesley comes along and starts experiencing these moves with the Holy Spirit and some other things. He said, you know what, experience needs to be added to this. And then sometime in the 20th century, somebody kind of formulated this into this thing. And so there's these four things that we use in theological reflection when the scripture is not explicitly clear. How do we discern what the Lord might be saying about a certain topic? First, we look at scripture. Prima scriptura, scripture is primary. Prima scriptura, scripture is primary. Scripture is the first place we go to try to understand, is this a right relationship for me? Is this a right friendship to me? And one of the questions we ask when we read the scriptures, when we open the book and we start to read, does this relationship take me closer to Christ? Does it take me closer to God, or does it draw me away from God? Does this relationship ask me to do things that violate and dishonor me before the Lord? For young people, if you got friends, are your friends asking you to do things that the Lord would not be pleased with? That's not a friendship that honors God. Are you dating someone that's asking you to do things that would dishonor the Lord? That's not a relationship from God. In other words, the scriptures let us know this is what's good and right before the Lord. And your friendships or your relationships should honor that. Next, there's tradition. Tradition may be your heritage, it may be your background, it may be your culture, it may be your subculture. And how does this relationship honor that? Do you have to be ashamed of who you are and where you come from or your background, whether it's socioeconomic or anything else or class? Do you have to be ashamed or do you have to hide that? Do you have to like pretend you're not who you really are in order to have this relationship? Third is reason. We can use sociology. We can use psychology. There's a lot of great studies and information that out there that tells us about what a healthy relationship looks like. And that information, some of it, you have to discern using the scriptures. Again, the scripture is primary, but you discern that information. You filter it through the scripture. But a lot of information is insight, wisdom coming through, whether it's secular or Christian, through the sciences that tell us, hey, this is what a healthy relationship should look like. And we can use that information to judge a healthy relationship. Then last is our experiences. A lot of us have had experiences. We either dated or we had friendships. We kind of recognize the warning signs of what a good friendship looks like versus a bad friendship or a good relationship versus a bad relationship. And we can use our experience, but we don't have to just use our experience. We can also use the experiences of those who are older and wiser. So that's why it's important to have the experiences of your community, of your village, of the elders, of those who's gone on before you to help you discern what a right relationship looks like. Going back to the scriptures, let's go into verse 21. It says, so the Lord caused the man to fall into a deep sleep, and while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs and then closed up the place with flesh. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken from the man and brought her to the man. And so hopefully Dr. Z won't mock me too much for my my awesome medical diagram here. So the Lord chose the rib. And so that got you get to thinking, okay, God, of all the pieces you could take, why did you choose the rib? And so I did a little medical research, and I found out that the rib cage protects at least three vital organs that I know of: the heart, the lungs, and the liver. The heart, the lungs, and the liver. And so when I started thinking about, okay, the heart. When the Bible talks about the heart, it talks about our soul, it talks about our emotions, it talks about our thoughts. The heart represents those emotions, the soul. So the rib cage protects the soul, the heart, the emotional state. And then I thought about the lungs. Well, that's the air. And every time the Bible talks about the breath of the air, it also refers to the spirit. So the ribs protects the breathing, the air, your spiritual life. But what's very interesting is that when you breathe in, the rib cage helps you expel by pushing weight back on your lungs when you're expelling. And so the good stuff comes in, but the rib cage helps you get the bad stuff out. Carbon monoxide is not good for us. And so the ribs are helping to work. The rib cage is helping to work to get the bad spiritual stuff out, as well as protecting, letting the good spiritual stuff comes in. And then the liver, I had to look this up because I wasn't sure what the liver did. All I know is I've eaten it as a kid on a sandwich. And so livers and onions, anybody? Livers and onions? Yeah. Yeah. Okay. All right. All right. A lot of shaking head, nose. All right. All right. So the liver, they said the liver actually takes a lot of toxic substances and makes them harmless to the body. And I was like, wow. So the ribs protect the vital organs. So the negative stuff that comes into your life, the liver is there to turn that into something harmless. All those negative thoughts, all those negative emotions, turn it into something harmless to you. And so when you think about relationships, life-driven relationships, the person you're with in life-driven relationships protect the emotional, the spiritual, the physical. The life-driven emotions, relationships are supposed to protect. So if you're in a relationship and you have a person that's causing you more harm than they are protecting you, you have to wonder about that relationship. Whether that's a friendship, whether that's a dating relationship, whether that's a marriage, there has to be some conversation. You know what? Life-driven relationships are supposed to protect, so why don't I feel protected in these areas? Then the scriptures goes on to say in verse 23, the man said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. Bone of bones, same, same. Flesh of flesh, same, same. Principle number 5, life-driven relationships are equally yoked. Life-driven relationships are equally yoked. I know we talked about in the scriptures all the time, we see in the Corinthians, it says, do not be unequally yoked with unbelievers. And for those of us who are from a farming community, you probably have some idea if you grew up on the farm, what that looks like. You might have seen some oxen being yoked, tilling the ground. But for a lot of us who didn't grow up on the farm, we have to go and do some research. So I found a picture. Because Deuteronomy in the law, it says, do not yoke a donkey with an ox. Because that is the idea of being unequally yoked. And so the yoke is this big wood that puts the animals together and they move along in tandem, in sync. But if one is bigger and stronger than the other, has a longer stride than the other, then the weaker animal or the animal that doesn't have as long of a stride will get dragged behind as the other one pulls forward and can get hurt. If we are unequally yoked with unbelievers, who's ever the strongest in that relationship is going to strongly influence the other person. And from what I've discovered, at least what the statistics says about our Christian culture, about how we don't know the scriptures as well as we should, we don't share the gospel as much as we should, that our Christianity looks very carnal. The reality is, most of us, if we're yoked with unbelievers, we're probably going to go the way of the unbeliever. Because let's just face it, the unbelievers, at least on the surface, look like they're always having more fun. They get to do all the fun stuff, the clubs and some other things. And then the Bible says, you know, stay on the straight and narrow. And that just doesn't seem as much fun. But not only can you be unequally yoked with unbelievers, you can be unequally yoked with believers. Something we don't talk about too much, but it is possible to be unequally yoked. Both of you are Christians. Both of you are the same animal. But one of you is so far ahead of the other one, or you have such different interests that you don't benefit one another. So a carnal Christian who says, I want to live carnally, I don't want to grow too much in the word, and a person who says, I'm all about the spirit, I want to read my Bible every day, and I want to be obedient to everything the Lord says, those two people are going to have a tough time aligning with one another, seeing eye to eye. The Bible says it this way, how can two walk together unless they agree? Back to the scriptures, verse 24, it says this, that is why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh. Life-driven relationship honors God's relational priority. Life-driven relationship honors God's relational priority. In marriage, the Lord says the husband and wife becomes one flesh. The man leaves his wife, becomes united, leaves his father and mother, becomes united with his wife. They are the unit. Guess who doesn't get a say? The parents. Guess who else doesn't get a say? The friends. Guess who else doesn't get a say? The children. Guess who else doesn't get a say? Anyone else who wants to interrupt your relationship. Now, you should accept wisdom from older people who've been married a long time. Hopefully, you're seeking out wisdom, saying, hey, how can I navigate this situation? How can I navigate this situation? How do you make your marriage last? You should seek godly wisdom from people who are older, who are elders, who've been down the path, who got something to share. But they don't get to dictate your marriage. And parents, if you're that mother-in-law or that father-in-law from the sitcoms who are kind of interrupting and interfering in that relationship, just understand that you are doing something that God doesn't approve of. He says they're one flesh. And husband and wives, if you're allowing outside influences, whether you're going to share information, oh, I just need to tell my friends everything that's going on in my marriage. No, you don't. Unless they are people of godly counsel and extreme wisdom that you really trust. But as a practice, you should never be taking all of your business out of your marriage to everyone in the community, all of your friends, all of your families. You're supposed to seek out godly counsel, godly wisdom. And if you do that, you should do that in consultation with your husband or your wife. And the reason you want to do that is so that it doesn't come across as you're dishonoring the other person, because life-driven relationships honors God's relational priority. Last but not least, as we get ready to close, Adam and his wife were both naked and felt no shame. Last principle, life-driven relationships are Christ-centered environments where we are fully alive and thrive. As I invite the worship team back up, life-driven relationships are Christ-centered environments where we as people in those relationships should be fully alive and we should be thriving. I just recently read a meme that talked about if a shark is put into a tank in captivity, it will grow about 8 inches. If it's left in the ocean, it will grow up to 8 feet. And they say that the fish can only grow to the restraints or to the borders or to the capacity of its environment. God created life-driven relationships for us to be able to be fully alive and fully thrive, to grow, and to grow. And he never called for us to be in a relationship where we are stifled, where we are held back, where we feel like we don't have a say, we don't feel like we're valued. That's not what God has called us to. God says, no, 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 no. If your relationship is the way I intended your relationship to be, you should be fully alive and you should be thriving. You should be growing by leaps and bounds. And so if you are the same person 10 years ago, 20 years ago that you are today, if you're that same person, look at your relationships. One of the great motivational speakers said this: you are the sum, or you're the average of the five people you spend the most time with. Who are your five closest relationships? And that will probably tell you how much you are growing and thriving. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for the opportunity for life-driven relationships, Lord. Lord, we ask that you surround us with people who can help us become closer to you, who can help us become fully alive, who can help us become the people you have designed us to be, Lord. A holy people, a royal priesthood, living lives that are abundant, agents of mercy, incarnational of Christ. And if we don't have those relationships, Lord, we don't know where to find them. We just ask that your Holy Spirit lead and guide those who want those relationships but don't have them. This we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
You may sit or stand with us as we worship.
Christ is risen.
It's all right. I just want to take a moment and just worship just for a couple of seconds more. That passage when it says, oh, what a Savior. Isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. What a powerful word. So if we could just take a moment, just sing through that just a couple of times as we prepare to remember the body and blood of our Savior.
Oh, what a Savior, isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Bow down before him, for he is Lord. Is risen. Oh, what a Savior! Isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah! Christ is risen. Bow down before. Is risen.
Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide.
If you have your elements, we invite you to take them now. If you don't have them, just let the ushers know and they'll be happy to bring it to you. As we take our hearts and minds to the foot of the cross, on the night in which he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and after he had given thanks, he broke it. And he said, "This is my body broken for you. As often as you eat, do so in remembrance of me." And likewise, he took the cup. And after he had given thanks, he said, "This is my blood, the blood of the new covenant that I shed for you. As often as you drink, do so in remembrance of me." Because when you eat of the bread and drink of the cup, you do proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for the broken body and the shed blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for how he has given us the right to have life-driven relationships, Lord. You placed us in community, Lord. You told us to bear the burdens of one another, God. And you said that we will know each other. They shall know us by the love that we have for one another, Lord. Lord, pour out your love upon us as we pour it out upon others, so that someone who is far away and disconnected from you can be returned to your fold. This we pray in Christ's holy name. Amen. At this time, we're going to invite our altar ministry teams to come up. If you desire prayer, all you would have to do is come to the front, and you can receive prayer from our altar ministry team here at the end of service. And if you had the opportunity, if you haven't had the opportunity, offering is in the back. Feel free to drop your offering in the box. And with that, I ask you to receive the benediction. May the Lord watch between me and thee while we are absent one from another. And the church said, amen. Go in peace and be a blessing. God bless you.
Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
What a Savior. What a Savior. Isn't he Precious blood of Jesus Christ.